This novel, The Literary Conference, it seems so subdued on the outside. It's so short. It's so easy to carry around. It's got such a... I love the cover that New Directions put on it, the blue shape. But on the inside, it's just packed full of buried treasure and lost loves and silkworms attacking a town and mad scientism. How much were you aware of Cesar Ayra's storytelling predilections, shall we say, before you read this book in the original?
Virtually not at all. I had read a couple of Chris Andrews translations, but I had no idea really what I was getting into. And when I first read it, my first impression was, oh, this is kind of easy to translate. And I was actually quite amazed at how much more demanding it was than I had originally thought when I had first read it. This happens often, actually, one way or the other. It was much more difficult than I had at first thought. Because it seemed just sort of, you know, short sentences, very straightforward, but there were so many twists and turns, both in the plot and but expressed in sort of line by line, which is what how a translator works, that it was rather intricate. It's much more intricate than meets the eye.
From KCSB in Santa Barbara and Colin Marshall Radio, this is the Marketplace of Ideas. I'm Colin Marshall, and today it is a special on Cesar Ayra. We're asking the question, who is Cesar Ayra besides being one of the most exciting, to my mind, Argentine writers today, and who's been writing for a long time, but in the U.S., in the English language world, we're only just starting to get his books. And right now I'm talking to the translator of The Literary Conference, Catherine Silver. Among many other Spanish language writers, Ayra is one she translates. And let me ask you this, I mean, what are some of the impressions you had of this book when you read it as a whole? What did you come away with, even in a sort of non-translatory way? What were you feeling about this book?
I just thought it was a hoot.
that's the best description I've read of this book so far. A hoot. It is a hoot.
It's a hoot. And when you translate, you read something over and over and over again. And I can't even count how many times I've read it. And I still get a chuckle. I feel a chuckle and a little smile on my face when I read it, parts of it. Even just the beginning. The whole Macuto line, it makes absolutely no sense, and it's absolutely hysterical, I think.
Yes, this Macuto line, this contraption that has that holds a buried treasure that only the main character of this book can happen upon and suddenly figure out how to work because of the combination of books he's read and the combination of experiences he's had that adds up to the solution to getting the chest of treasure out of the water. And that's one of these things I think about this book. I think about how this main character describes something like that, where it comes down to this combination of experiences, many of them cultural, that are a solution to a problem. And the character is also a translator, and he's talking about a lot of other things in the book, a lot of these other crazy developments, you know, verging on, as he says, a B-grade science fiction movie developments. He frames these things in translatorial terms, does he not?
That's right.
As a translator yourself, how do you feel about the way this seems to be shot through with translation?
I loved it. I mean, I think his whole attitude is not only in this book, he deals with it directly. He names it as he says, now I'm going to go to another level and translate it. I loved it as a translator, because he's really using the word translation to talk about different levels of perception and reality. And that is what we do. And that is sort of a deeper level of interest as a translator. So I just love it. I also felt that Ayra was sort of winking at me as the translator, not directly, but there were sort of little, I don't know, perhaps this was completely made up. I have no idea, but I just felt that the fact that he was using that metaphor of translation to talk about going on different levels of reality, I also felt that he was sort of setting little traps, little funny traps for me as a translator in the text. And I can't think of any specific examples right now, but that was sort of added to my chuckle, to my, the sense of it being so funny.
Now, critics tend to make a lot of the fact that Ira was or is in real life. I don't know if he still does it, but he has translated a lot of genre fiction into Spanish. And this is a book, as we've said, translation is such a big deal with the main character and also genres. I mean, it's just it. People who haven't read Ira before, they remark on how it flips genre, and then kind of transcends them all. I want to know what you think about Ira's past as a translator or a present. I'm not sure, but the fact that he's translated so much genre stuff, is that worth thinking about as a reader of a book like The Literary Conference?
I think so. I mean, to the extent that translation is understood or misunderstood, or I sense it as a translator, the ways in which he approaches language and he approaches plot, he's kind of standing back from it all. It's like being one step removed, and he can dip in and out. He can imitate genres. And that's what we do. We, as translators, we are mimics. We are basically mimics. And so the fact that he had that experience translating and probably seeing the intricacies of these plots and seeing how they don't really work, because when you're a translator, you read things very, very closely. So he can then extrapolate from that and make fun of it and then do it in his own work. I think that might be one way one could look at it.
This notion of Ira's plots not really working, that's something that is brought up equally, I find, by his boosters, by his biggest boosters as well as his biggest detractors. I understand most of the detractors are in the Spanish-speaking world, not so much in the Anglosphere, but I can tell that you must not find that to be a problem, the fact that the plots don't quote-unquote work.
Well, to tell you the truth, I think in some of his books, they don't. There was one book that was proposed to me to translate, and I recommended to the publisher that I didn't think it worked. And actually, then I later read online that Ida himself said that he didn't think that one worked. So I don't think they always work, but and I think sometimes that is a problem, that there's just not enough of a core intention that carries you through. But no, I have no problem. I think the way he plays with plot and the fact that sometimes they don't work in a traditional sense is another way in which Ida is poking holes in a veneer of fiction or literature, what we think of as authorial control, that I find fascinating and gives me a new way of looking and reading and seeing and perceiving the world and books and literature.
Now, we talk about the books of Ira's that work and the ones that don't, but the listener might not understand if they're not familiar. This is a man with over 60 books, I believe, to his name in the original language. So tell us, and I won't ask only about the Literary Conference, but tell us where the Literary Conference fits in this vast body of work, all with fairly small page counts, but a vast body of titles Ira has written.
I'm going to defer to, I think Chris Andrews knows Ida's complete body of work better than I do. I have that impression. And so I think he's a better person to ask about that. I really feel that I'm not in a position to, I don't know all of his works that well. So I just know several of his books. I think some of them work better than others. I've read things he said, but personally, I can't really judge that. I love the Literary Conference. I love the landscape painter. And I love the one I'm working on now for New Directions, which is Dr. Ida's Miracle Cures. I'm the jury's out if I like it better than the Literary Conference.
And that's, I'm going to have some questions about that, because all of what I've read about that book has been in Spanish, and my Spanish, I don't have the command that I would need to actually understand an article about that book very much. So I want to get into that first, though, by way of asking you about the way that Ira uses reality, because there are elements of reality in the Literary Conference, as unreal and as fantastical as it gets. To combine the two, I mean, there is a moment of combination of the mad scientist plot where this main character, also, of course, named Cesar, a translator, and one who hatches a plan to clone Carlos Fuentes, best known author of his generation from his country, and that's his
plan. Actually, Carlos Fuentes is from Mexico.
Yeah, that's what I meant. I thought
right.
From
Mexico. Yes.
From Mexico.
Okay,
yeah.
Sorry.
But then I realize I'm wrong because, of course, Garcia Marquez is probably better known than Fuentes. But in any case, however wrong or right I might be, I do know for a fact the Cesar character wants to clone Carlos Fuentes.
Yes.
And this is his method, to his means of achieving world domination. But, you know, the world domination plot is made up. Carlos Fuentes is real. I want to know what your impression is of how Ira uses real stuff like Carlos Fuentes in this book. What do you think of it?
Well, again, I think there's just a level of irreverence in Ida's imagination and in his willingness to maintain that imagination uncensored. And how he, I mean, what I think is most brilliant about Ida is the way he can put onto paper his wildest imagination and make it coherent at all to the reader. And so you get a sense of an imagination that's just very, very free. And free associating and going and moving along almost in a lucid dream state often. And that he can then put that onto paper. And I think so many writers find that difficult to do. So reality comes in, of course, it comes into dreaming. You know, in a dream, you can have a real person, but doing something completely ridiculous. So it feels to me sort of like a dreamlike state.
It's kind of like when someone's talking about their dreams and they'll say, well, I was in a building, but it was kind of my house, but it was kind of also my elementary
right.
school. And you were there, but you were also my grandpa.
It's, exactly.
That's
exactly.
Thing.
Yeah. That's sort of how I see it. But he names it. He in the, you know, I'm just working on it a couple pages here where he keeps going on in real reality. He uses the term real
yes,
reality.
Yes, yes.
So it's, you know, God knows what he, you know. Translate that. You know?
And this, I think, gets to maybe the core of Ira's strength is that, you know, I talk about these dream retellings people do, talking about you were my first grade teacher and my grandpa came up to me in on the street, except it was Argentina, but also San Francisco. These are not normally stories you want to hear from somebody retelling their dreams because they don't make any sense and they're too personal to connect. Yet, I think, at least I know I do, want to read it when Ira does it. I mean, he's not maybe retelling his dreams, but what is he doing differently to make it compelling and not like those stories at the water cooler, you know? Oh,
that's a very good question. It's his storytelling ability, the shape and form of his imagination, which is so unusual. And the fact that this is not dream telling. This is... Oh God. That's a hard question to answer coherently.
It might be the ultimate question about him, I realize. So I expect I don't expect the definitive response, but I'm sure you'll agree. It's a fascinating road to go down as far as
it is a fascinating road to go down, but to warn it, we're not talking either some kind of surrealism.
Yes.
This is not free association. This is not surrealism. There's something else at work here. I'm not sure what it is. But I love it.
Indeed. And, you know, we mentioned that the main character in this book is like the author named Cesar and that Carlos Fuentes comes up. And you mentioned the book that you are working on translating now, Dr. Ira's Miracle Cures. I don't know if that's exactly the translation they're going with for the finished book, but...
I'm not either, right.
But it'll be something like that, I'm
sure.
Something
like that.
Now, I don't know how much to draw from the fact that the character has his same last name, but tell us a little bit about that book. I'm kind of just dying to know more about it.
You know, again, it's hard to summarize his plots because they go all over the place. But basically, this is a person, a doctor, Dr. Ida, who spends a lot of his time sort of sleepwalking almost, daydreaming. And he has an arch enemy, Dr. Akhtin, I think it would be pronounced. And Dr. Ida is known for his miracle cures, even though he's never carried one out, nor has he ever. So he's about to embark on a publishing project of installments. He's decided on the installment plan. but it's brilliant what he does. I mean, I think there's an entire philosophy in this book and his entire poetics. And what he basically talks about his art and his work here. There's so many levels to read this book on, and it's all of 70 pages, even shorter than a literary conference. Yeah.
I want to know what you think that brevity what that brevity gives his work. And now I realize that question might be wrong, because as I've read from him, he himself says his work just settles at a natural stopping point with the methods he uses around the short points that they do. But the brevity seems appealing to me, and I'm not quite sure why it goes beyond convenience. But what do you think about the importance of it in the books of his that you've been exposed to?
It's a way, I think, because his imagination seems so limitless, I think, but he set himself these short, installments. I mean, I think that's what this book is talking about, right? That these are each kind of installments. These are kind of, that sets a limit. He can go wild with his imagination, but as long as he keeps the form short, he's not going to get lost in the, it sets a limit that he doesn't want to set on his imagination. Does that make sense?
It does. And I'm picturing the unlimited César Aira novel, you know, one that goes 500 pages long. And as much as I enjoy his novels as they are, I suspect I maybe wouldn't want to read a 500 page novel.
That's right. And I think one, you're holding this small book and you're willing to go along with him into blue worms and cloned writers or wasps or whatever he's doing, and the destruction of entire city, because you see that you're coming to an end, that you're not going to have to stay there with him in this. You're not going to have to stay in your leap of faith for very long. You can land and with him and then sort of wonder at where you've been.
Now, the English reading reader, you might be attracted by one of these books. They might well be. And I've met many who have been, even as they've just started getting real publication here in the U.S. And they might read Aira and think, well, maybe this is the way. Maybe this is the way these Argentine authors are. Maybe this is the way these Spanish writing authors are. And since you've translated a number of very high-profile writers in the Spanish language, I want to ask you, what do you think about Aira's place in the world of Spanish language fiction today? I mean, it sounds so broad to say that, and I don't mean to sound so grand, but how do you fit him in mentally with the other authors you've translated?
I don't know if there is a coherent world anymore of Latin American writers. I mean, I think there are many different trends that are going on. And I also, given the circumstances in the world today, you have to look at it in a broader, more global sense. I think what Aira's doing does fit within he's definitely Argentinian. There's many, many nods at Borges and other writers from Argentina that are popular and are well known and part of the canon in Argentina. I think what Aira's doing is quite unique globally. I don't know of anybody else who is doing what he's doing. and how it fits in terms of other writers in Latin America, like I said, I think it's hard to make generalizations right now about even from a particular country. I mean, I know there are other writers in Argentina who are doing completely different things. In Mexico, there's many, many writers, each of them doing something very different. So it's hard for me right now to think about any kind of general trends.
Indeed, it's when you think about this, the whole scope, even just the geographical territorial
yes.
scope of this world, it seems ridiculous to think one would be able to make a statement that covered that whole. These are the Spanish language
exactly.
writing authors, but I do wonder, and this will sound just as abstract, I think, but what I do wonder. I mean, it's just a pure curiosity. What of Argentina comes through Aira? I mean, could we think of him as a voice that's not totally tied to a nationality, or is there some like inseparable part of Argentina coming through him that we would be ignorant of if we don't know about Argentina itself?
No, the answer is no. He's very translatable in that respect. He's not tied to a particular set of cultural values, or he is definitely an author that can be translated, is translatable in the sense of culture and context. And there are certain, like I say, there are nods. There are nods to a literary tradition. There are nods to economic or historical conditions. There are nods to personalities or sort of moments, but that's inevitable. And that's one of the things that a translator has to deal with, is how does one create a new context? How does one take things out of context? But I think in Aira, less than in a lot of authors. It's nothing insuperable, insurmountable. And what he's doing, I think, is universal and can be appreciated on a universal basis. But just to go back for one moment to what you said about the trends, I think seeing Latin American literature as one whole, like taking magical realism as representative of Latin American literature or of any literature is something that happens in the United States to a certain extent. Mm. It's something that happens, we tend to take one author and say, this is what's going on in Latin America. When in fact, there are 20 other authors that maybe don't get translated or don't get the press or aren't as translatable in that respect. But they are going on at the same time. So it is a simplification that we tend to do in translation.
I've been speaking for this first segment of the Who is Cesar Ara special with Catherine Silver, translator of the Literary Conference and the forthcoming Dr. Ira's Miracle Cures, or some version of that sentence, I'm sure. Catherine, thanks so much for taking the time to come on the show today.
Thank you very much for talking to me and talking to translators about the work they do.
Just tuning in, this is the Marketplace of Ideas, and I'm Colin Marshall. This week, we've got a special going, asking the question, who is Cesar Ayra? He is, of course, an Argentine novelist, getting more and more popular all the time in the English-speaking world, and that is thanks, in large part, to the efforts of my three guests today. I've got Catherine Silver, translator of the Literary Conference and co-director of the Banff International Literary Translation Center, Chris Andrews, translator of How I Became a Nun, an episode in the life of a landscape painter, and Ghosts, and Rosalie Knecht, translator of The New, The Seamstress, and The Wind. When this conversation is broadcast, or I should say, when these three conversations are, you can hear the whole show again on your iPod, on your Zune, on your computer, on whatever, by visiting colinmarshallradio.com. It's in the official Marketplace of Ideas interview archive, where they're all kept, every single interview the program has ever done, there, free for the downloading, or on iTunes. Just go to the iTunes store and search for the Marketplace of Ideas and download them there as well if you like. Also on colinmarshallradio.com, the easy way to subscribe to the weekly Marketplace of Ideas mailing list. Updates on current and upcoming Marketplace of Ideas interviews, as well as other related interestingness on the internet. That's colinmarshallradio.com. Now, back to the special on Cesar Ayra for more cultural conversation of the depth you demand on the Marketplace of Ideas. I struggle a lot to describe the works of Cesar Ayra to English language readers in terms of other sort of native Anglophone writers. I try in vain to look for writers to compare him to who natively write in English. Tell me, do you think this is even possible?
That's a good question. I couldn't really think now of anyone who would be a good comparison with him. I'm afraid I can't. I can't come up with anyone.
And I want to get to the bottom of why that is. But first, let me tell the audience, welcome to part two of this special on the works of Cesar Ayra. We're asking the translators, the English language translators of his books, who exactly this fellow is, and what is the story with why can't I describe his books, I suppose, is one main question. I'm talking with Chris Andrews for this segment. He's the translator of three currently published Ayra books, an episode in the life of a landscape painter, Ghosts, and How I Became a Nun, with a new one, Varamo, coming out next year from New Directions, as they all do. Now, Chris, I want to get a little deeper into why exactly. Well, tell me this first. Tell me, is it the same situation with writers in Spanish? Is it as hard to come up with comparisons?
It's perhaps not quite as hard, because I think he comes partly out of a tradition of Latin American and particularly Argentinian surrealism. So in his formative years, he was good friends with Alejandro Pizarnik, the poet, who could be called a kind of late surrealist poet, with Osvaldo Lamborghini, who was a poet and fiction writer, a kind of cult figure in Argentina. And so some aspects of his method derive from the historical avant-garde in Latin America. So, he's perhaps not as disorienting there, but still, I think, hard to get a handle on. even in Latin America.
Now, in the Anglosphere, you're known as the most prolific translator of Ayra's works because you've translated so far three that are in publication as opposed to one from the other two translators I will be talking to in this program. How did you first encounter Ayra's works as a reader?
I read him first in 2001. I'd tried to read a book called Emma the Captive, Emma la Cautiva, which is a fairly early book of his, set in the 19th century on the Pampa. And I really didn't get it for a start, and I stopped. And then later that year, I picked up an episode in the life of a landscape painter. I actually remember quite clearly having a kind of illumination, suddenly feeling that I got it and that I understood what he was doing. And since then, I've become a bit of an addict or a collector, as readers of Cesarara are. You know, we collect the books, which are often quite hard to find, and there are always a few that are waiting to be got and read. And that book, an episode in the life of a landscape painter, has been, well, that was the first that New Directions published. There had been one published in England before that called The Hare, La Liebre, translated by Nick Caistor and published by Serpent's Tile. But I don't think that's circulating much in the U.S.
Now, the book, An Episode in the Life of a Landscape Painter, which you've translated into English, that book, in the context of the 60 or so that Ayra has written, I read people write about this book, and they say, even if they say, I didn't like a lot of what I had read of Ayra's, I came across Episode in the Life of a Landscape Painter, and this was the book that, if not made me come around, then at least for some critics, they give their grudging appreciation to this book if they give it to no other of his. Why is that?
I'm not sure. I guess I would say that it's atypical of his production in general, but then it's hard to think of books that are typical because he's constantly trying to, I think as soon as he notices that there's a recurrent pattern in his work, he tries to break with that. This one maybe is a good point of entry for readers because it doesn't do the radical genre shifting that he does in some of his books. So some of them will begin quite realistically, and then jump abruptly into a different kind of book altogether. There's one called The Proof, La Prueba, which does this very violently. It begins as a kind of psychological novel about a girl who's picked up by a pair of lesbians on the street, and they go and have coffee in a cafe, and then suddenly at a place that you can pinpoint on a page, it becomes a kind of ultraviolet action movie. And so that's the sort of thing that happens in some of the books, and that is bewildering or disappointing for a lot of readers. So an episode in the life of a landscape painter doesn't really do that, although it does swerve quite dramatically when the landscape painter, Rugendas, is struck by lightning and disfigured, and his life changes completely.
I want to know what you think about... I don't know if the why is the right question to ask here, but what do you know about the fact that Ayra's works, I mean, he's been publishing novels since, I believe, 1975, and only now in the 2010s and late 2000s are we really starting to see his books come out translated, come out in some kind of force in the English reading world. What can we use to explain that?
Well, one thing we can use, I think, is the fact that English is often one of the last languages to receive an author in translation. So Ayra was translated in French very early on, and then there was a bit of a pause, and now he's being translated again in French. And so a lot more of his books have appeared in French. So English is often the last one. I guess another factor would be that the books are really strange, and that even his reception in Spain has been quite slow. It was really only in the 90s, I think, that the Spanish began to read him in significant numbers and to publish him there.
did his books become, I mean, was there a change in the books to get him read more, or was there a change in readers? What does it seem like?
I think there has been a slow change in the books, but I think it's just that not that the books have become less strange. I think, if anything, they've become more strange as they've gone on. They've become shorter. Some of the earlier books were long, and there's one that's quite long called Canto Castrato, which was apparently an attempt to write a bestseller, but didn't work at all. And you can see why, because the plot, it's about a castrato in Italy, an opera singer. The plot keeps drifting and swerving, and it doesn't knit up neatly at the end at all. It's a wonderful book, but it's a strange kind of unidentified object, really, not a potential bestseller at all.
Because a lot of people who are picking up Adler's books now that you and others have translated them, they're people who may not have a lot of experience in the world of Argentine fiction. They might not know, they might be completely ignorant of Spanish. And I don't want to put this question like, what are they missing from the experience of reading Ira in Spanish, but what is it important for a reader in English of Ira to know about if they have never gone near the culture from which he emerges?
He emerges from a culture of a highly intellectualized literary culture where the figure of Borges is very important. And Borges as a thinker about writing and not just as a creator of imaginary worlds. So the tendency that Ira has to step back and reflect on what he's doing as he's doing it, or to make his characters think in general or philosophical terms, that has a lot to do with the national tradition, I think, and especially with Borges. What the readers are missing, well, they'll be missing a lot of the flavor of the local Argentinian Spanish, which is something that's very hard to... Well, a lot of it is lost in translation. So things like the use of the verb form with the pronoun vos, which is something specific to the Rio de la Plata region, that goes. There's a very nice essay by Cesar Ira called The Incomprehensible, which is out there on the web somewhere, Lo Incomprensible. And in that essay, he says that as soon as a work of literature crosses a national boundary, goes beyond a national boundary, and is received elsewhere, it's almost bound to be misunderstood. But he doesn't see that as necessarily an unfortunate thing. He sees it as a kind of proliferation of meanings and an opportunity for the work to be loved in different ways. So, you know, I think that things will be lost, but it's not necessarily something to be lamented.
It's interesting because when I read things that Ira says in interviews or when I read commentary on his novels, it seems like in Ira's world, decisions are allowed and even encouraged and even made successfully that would be harshly discouraged in other novels, with other authors, in other settings. You know, in some sense, it's doing the wrong thing is, in an Ira context, doing the right thing. And, you know, I think of translation, I think of how there's, in a certain sense, translating a novel from its original language does, you may lose something in the finer language of it, but you might also gain a certain clarity on the ideas expressed within it. And I mean, that seems like a kind of Ira way of thinking about it. Would you agree, though, that in his world, in the world of his literature, the rules are so different from any other writer that you almost can't make a comparison?
I think it is very hard, I think that's why he likes to publish, especially in Argentina with these very small publishing houses, because they, you know, they're happy just to have something by him, and they're not really worried about printing a large number of copies or trying to bend him to their idea of what a good novel is. So I think it offers him a special freedom to continue to publish with the small presses. So he does in Spain and in Latin American countries publish with big presses. Yeah, I think I might have lost the thread of your original question.
Yeah, but I want to get your thinking on how to put it, because it seems like with Ira's work, bad can be good, good can be bad. It's like the distinction. Why almost bother making it? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, in a sense, he doesn't bother. He often says that for him the important thing is to write a book that will be new and different and surprising, in the hope that it may one day become a kind of paradigm for a new set of literary values. So when he talks about bad and good, he means bad and good measured according to a currently received set of values. In a way, he's hoping to write for the future, to experiment and make something that may come to be regarded as good later on, but is necessarily going to seem bad now. That's the avant-garde logic that he's working with. And yet, I think it would probably be a pity just to accept that logic in a docile way and always to explain his work in the terms that he uses, because I think his work does all sorts of things that his own critical vocabulary doesn't really highlight or illuminate. For example, the creation of interesting characters and atmospheres, and the observation of workplaces and leisure activities and so on. These are things that he doesn't talk about when he does interviews, but that I think his fiction does. And this sometimes adds to its disorienting quality, because you'll have a character who has a certain psychological fitness at one point in the book and then is squashed flat, as it were, by the change of genre. So when it becomes the ultra-violent action film, then all the psychology of the character disappears because they're engaged in violent acts, basically. there's no space for psychology once the action takes off in that.
Now, there is the quote that New Directions has not been shy about using in promotion of Ira, the one from Roberta Bolaño, which is, once you've started reading Ira, you don't want to stop. And since Bolaño is the other author you're well known for translating into English, I want to get a sense from you, and I know we've talked about how it's not a very fruitful effort to compare Ira to other writers, but is there anything to be gained by taking these two, taking Bolaño and Ira, putting their work side by side, and can you draw anything from a comparison between them, or from looking at the differences between them, or from just thinking about the fact that they are becoming popular in English at the same time?
Yeah, I think they're very different writers, and I think the fact that they're becoming popular at the same time is largely a coincidence. The quote from Bolaño about not wanting to stop, that applies perfectly to my experience. I don't want to stop. when he wrote that, though, I think he probably himself had really only just begun to read Ira. He hadn't read very much, and he didn't, in the end, have time to read very much, because he died shortly after that. They're really quite different writers, thematically, tonally quite different. Ira's styled himself as a frivolous writer, and there are areas of, if you like, obvious subject matter that he hasn't dealt with directly. For example, he hasn't written about the military government in Argentina. He doesn't delve into national and personal wounds. The way he handles his autobiography in his fiction is very different from the way that Bolaño does. Bolaño's a writer who keeps revisiting his life and fictionalizing it, and I think drawing on the diaries and journals that he kept from the 70s on. Whereas what Ira does is to, in a way, to fictionalize the diary before it even gets written. So the novels themselves are a kind of fictionalized diary. He says that he incorporates things that happen to him or that he notices happening around him into the books as he writes them, but doesn't keep a diary. So I think there's a very different approach to experience in the work of the two authors. It's probably true that, you know, the success, the surprising and very considerable success of Bolaño in the U.S. Has opened the door to some degree for Ira. That is, it's made it possible for a publisher like New Directions to commit itself to publishing a series of titles.
Now, Now, finally, I want to know this from you, just as a reader of Ira, not even as a translator necessarily. When you read his books, what do you think that Ira brings literature that literature needs? I mean, that's kind of a grand sounding question, but what does he deliver that is missing from other writers, whether they write in Spanish or otherwise? I find every author that I love does that. They all bring something different, but they bring something absolutely necessary to my mind. To yours, does Ira bring something necessary?
Yes. I'll have to see how I can formulate it. One thing is and unpredictability and surprise, although, you know, I'm kind of repeating the cliches about Ira. another thing that's perhaps less of a cliche is fine attention to the details of the world around him. And I think there's an almost naturalistic aspect to his work, an almost Zola-like aspect. For example, in Ghosts, he describes how a family of Chilean construction workers live on the building site, where one of them is employed not only as a builder but as a night watchman. And it's really fascinating to read about, you know, how this worked in the 80s with a family of Chilean immigrants in Buenos Aires. Or in other books, he talks about the world of gymnasium, or he talks about the people who live in the shanty towns scavenging through rubbish bins before the rubbish collection. So, you know, what people usually say about Ira is he's completely wacky, he's completely unpredictable and surprising, which was what I was saying a moment ago. But and that's true, but the surprises are connected and grow out of this careful observation of real life. So I guess it's the combination of freewheeling fantasy and realism that's really unusual.
I've been speaking during the second segment of the Cesar Ira special with Chris Andrews, translator into English of How I Became a Nun, an episode in the life of a landscape painter, Ghosts, and the forthcoming Varamo. Chris, thanks for taking the time to come on the program today.
It's a pleasure, Colin.
For those just tuning in, this is the Marketplace of Ideas, and I'm Colin Marshall. It's a special this week asking one question. Who is Cesar Ira? Of course, I'm asking a lot of questions to the translators of this Argentine novelist, just now getting popular in the English-speaking world. These are his English-language translators, Catherine Silver, Chris Andrews, and Rosalie Knecht. Catherine Silver translated the Literary Conference, and she co-directs the Banff International Literary Translation Center. Chris Andrews translated How I Became a Nun, an episode in the life of a landscape painter, and Ghosts. And Rosalie Knecht translated The New, The Seamstress, and The Wind. You can hear this show again at colinmarshallradio.com in podcast form or on the iTunes store. You can download it from either place. On colinmarshallradio.com, just click the Marketplace of Ideas logo. You'll get to its main site. And on iTunes, open up the iTunes store and search for the Marketplace of Ideas. And if you want weekly updates on all things Marketplace of Ideas, it is very simple, very easy. It is the Marketplace of Ideas mailing list. You can subscribe on colinmarshallradio.com. Now back to the special, getting deeper into the question of who is Cesar Ira on the Marketplace of Ideas, cultural conversation of the depth you demand. In reading another interview with you about Cesar Ira, you mentioned something that I found so resonant about his work, which is that his novels have a weirdness to them. I think everybody would agree about that. But it's a kind of sincere weirdness. And tell me, what is that sincere weirdness of Ira a refreshing break from? Like, what kind of weirdness is it opposed to?
I think that the market in the U.S. is a little bit more strict with novelists in some ways. And so you end up getting... we tend to stick to a fairly conventional plot structure. And so when you do mix a little weirdness in, it's often sort of set pieces, you know, a little bit of magical realism, an unusual turn of events, something that couldn't really happen. But it's always within a plot that is pretty conventional, pretty straightforward, moving, a lot of conventionally structured. in his case, he is disregarding kind of basic continuity issues a lot of the time. He'll pick up threads and then drop them. You know, he'll switch genders. He'll sort of start down like a self-conscious authorial path and then just head away from it. So like the basic structure of the thing is where the weirdness is. And that to me seems like the difference. It's not sort of like adding like a little sprinkle of something that is not realistic for flavor. It's like the, it's basic. Its foundations are kind of shifting all the time.
For this third segment of the show's special on who exactly is Cesar Aira, we're speaking with Rosalie Knecht, the translator of The Seamstress and the Wind, the most recent book of, well, actually, I should put it this way, because the dates of publication in Spanish and the dates of publication in English can be all different. So it's the most recent book to appear in English, not necessarily his most the most recently written of them, but, well, we'll work all that continuity out. It is the most newly published book in the English language of Cesar Aira's, and it is her first book as a translator. And I want to get a deeper sense as well of what drew you to Aira's work in the first place, because, of course, you've mentioned before that this book was originally packaged with How I Became a Nun, which was translated into English by the fellow we heard from on the last segment, Chris Andrews. And you mentioned elsewhere that you read that book, How I Became a Nun, and that was the one that turned you on to Cesar Aira's style of weirdness?
Yeah, it was. I think it's a good example, because there are a couple of things that are very seriously weird in that book. I would say the primary one is that the title is How I Became a Nun, right. But I hope this isn't a spoiler. He doesn't become a nun. He dies at the age of 6. So you have a first-person narrated novel in which the main character and narrator dies at the end, which sort of, you know, it messes with the whole concept, actually, of a novel being in the past tense in the first person, because who's telling the story? And then in addition to that, it's How I Became a Nun. The main character is referred to by everyone around him with female pronouns, but refers to himself with masculine pronouns and is named Cesar Aira, so, but never addresses this disparity.
yes, of course not.
So that was those two things I found really kind of cheeky and fun. And also the novel that they're in is very, it's kind of fast moving and jokey and digressive and everything. So it was something that was, you could call it experimental, but it didn't have any of the kind of self-seriousness or dourness that I associated with that idea.
It is fascinating because I'm sure some listeners will hear this and they'll hear your description of How I Became a Nun and they'll think to themselves, oh, here we go, another one of these books. Like they'll think of that as like kind of a, they might mistakenly think of it as one of these tiresome exercises in weirdness. But, you know, I want to pin down like how he makes all that stuff work. It seems like it could be just a collection of strange authorial mannerisms, but it avoids that, and you'll probably know better than me how he avoids that.
There's a lack of calculatedness, I think, that comes through when you're reading it, which makes you excuse a lot of things that maybe you would find precious if they were handled poorly. And I think that comes from the fact that a lot has been made of this, that he his method is that he writes a page a day and he doesn't really go back and edit. Now, he claims in some interviews to never edit at all, and that's not entirely true. But for the most part, he just keeps heading forwards. And I think that on the one hand feels very unfamiliar because, of course, most writers edit and edit and edit and pick up any loose ends and smooth everything down and make choices very consistent. On the other hand, it feels very familiar because this is the way everyone makes up a story on the first draft. It's the way everyone comes up with their first plot. They start with from some point and they move to another point, another point, and they find some dead ends along the way. But it's moving quickly because it's going from point A to B to C without going backwards. So I think it's both familiar and strange to people at the same time.
It is a method that we've kind of alluded to in the previous two segments with his other English translators, but we've never quite focused on that flight forward of his, the way he keeps moving. And, you know, even if he does some editing, it's perhaps quite a bit less editing than any other novelist does. Now, I want to talk about how this method of his comes to bear on approaching a book like The Seamstress and the Wind as a translator, because you're going back to, I believe, 1991, when this was originally written in Spanish, and you're meeting with Cesar Ayra, and you are going over a book that kind of might as well be another author's book to him in a certain sense, right?
You know, once he's done with a book, he doesn't look back at it, which I think actually is more common than people realize. Yeah. Once you no longer have the power to fix something that you've written, you don't really want to engage with it, because I think you're afraid that you'll see something that you wish you could fix. For any writer. But anyway, yeah, so he and he writes so many books that when I was showing him you know, sticky spots that I'd come to where I wasn't sure what he meant or what he intended, sometimes he just said, "I don't remember."
Nice.
You know, he just sort of shrugged, like, you know, I don't really know what I meant right there. So do your best with it. You know.
And working with that, you know, I wanna build on this a little bit, or at least build some context into this, because we've mentioned that The Seamstress and the Wind was packaged with How I Became a Nun, the book that got you interested in Ayra in the first place. But I want to know, what are the other reasons to translate this, to pick this as the one? And correct me if I'm wrong, but you got to sort of choose what you wanted to pitch as the book to translate as part of the Fulbright that you did this on, right?
I did, yeah. When I applied for the project, I had not picked a book. And I really was kind of feeling around in the dark on this. I wasn't sure how people went about this. Now I'm pretty sure that I've concluded that there isn't really one way that people go about it, because yes. It's not something that very many people do. So there's not really a standardized method. But basically, I had proposed working with him, and I thought that I would ask him which book I should read, or which book I should translate, rather. I read The Seamstress and the Wind because I had it. I had a copy of it because it was packaged with this book that I had been given to read in a class. And I really liked it. And I thought, well, I should ask him if I could do that one. That was basically my thought process. And then I actually read it on the plane on the way to Argentina, which reveals maybe a lack of preparation. But
preparation is not the Ayra way.
That's true. That's true. I think he would be sympathetic to that. So I read it on the plane, and then I met him 2 days later, and I said, I just read this one. Could I translate that one? And he said, yeah, sure, whatever. And I said, is there another one that you think might be more appropriate? And he said, a writer is not a good judge of his own work. And right. I figured that the subject was sort of closed. So I went ahead and translated that one.
Now, let's not hold back on the listener anymore. I mean, we should describe a little bit about this actual book, The Seamstress and the Wind, the most recent release from New Directions of Cesar Ayras. And I want to say first, it seems to me, and I've only read the translated books. My command of Spanish isn't quite good enough to go into the originals. So tell me if I'm right or wrong about this, but The Seamstress and the Wind seems like a book more overtly concerned with the mechanics of storytelling, with how storytelling works, than his other novels. Do you have a sense of if that's true or false?
I think that's true. I think it's more on that end of the spectrum. I know that another book of his, which I actually haven't read, that's coming out next, called Varamo, is about a Panamanian bureaucrat who writes one poem. So I think that one is probably sort of preoccupied with the mechanics of writing and all that. But yeah, I mean, the way that he mixes in the process of writing into the book, he talks about, there's a funny sequence where he's talking about the fact that he's sitting in a cafe in Paris and he's too inhibited to call the waiter over and he needs yes. change. So he can't leave. He's trapped at this table. he has a dinner party to get to and he can't leave. So it mixes it in. And in this funny way that kind of shows you the kind of journeyman aspect of it. He works hard and he works consistently, and it's not the dissolute romantic hero kind of thing. It's like every day I go and I do this, it's my job. Which is appealing to me, I think. He mixes in the self-doubt and the kind of the quirks of it and all that kind of ground level stuff.
And given the evident and unpredictable mixture between fact and fiction in Ayra's books, I wonder, since you were able to meet with him and talk with him, to work closer than many do with the authors they translate on this book, what do you make of the idea that someone, just a reader, can come to know Cesar Aira through his books? I mean, there's obvious, I don't know about obvious, but there's elements that seem like they come straight from him. There's elements that seem like they come way far away from him. But what is it even possible to know something about the man if you stick only to the novels?
In some ways, I think you would know him more intimately than you would if he, you know, was your neighbor or something like that, someone that you knew socially. Obviously, I guess that goes without saying. He's a fairly private person, and I don't really have a sense, besides the, you know, I know that he was born in Coronel Pringles, and then he moved to Buenos Aires when he was 18, and has lived there ever since. He's married and has a daughter. That's basically all I know about his personal life, and he tends to keep it that way. But I think that you get a good sense of the way he is as a person from reading them. I mean, he's a shy kind of, you know, head in the clouds type of person, I think, with a very wide-ranging imagination. And he's very much very conscious of the tradition that he's inheriting as an Argentine writer. And all of that comes across pretty clearly, I think. There's a real, you know, he doesn't filter the sort of neurotic preoccupations that he has. And so there's no embarrassment about that. And so I think you can really, you get kind of a close look at that, which is fun.
Now, since this is your first book as a translator, I want to ask, well, it seems like, and I mean, this is just a total quick impression that I have, but there's a certain freshness that might give it, you know, where that you might not have if you had been kind of laboriously translating Spanish language bestsellers or what have you for decades and decades up to now. Like, I know that it doesn't make a lot of sense to ask how it makes it different for this to be your first book translated, because what do you compare it to? But what sense do you have about what about this being the first book you've translated, and what that might give the whole enterprise of translation that you've just sort of started on?
I was shocked that anyone would give me the chance to do this, because
you feel like you wow, I got away with it.
Yeah, totally. And I thought, you know, I had to do, a professor suggested that I do it. I didn't think that I could do something like that. And he said, sure, why not, you know? And I thought, well, okay. And then I had to write a letter to this writer whose book I had read in a course and ask him if I could translate his book on the basis of, like, just please, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
And it seemed very, basically the point that I'm trying to make is that I was terrified of screwing up because I thought that all of these nice people had given me a shot. And so I went over it. I was actually, I was trying, you know, every word, words that I was only 50% familiar with, I would look up in the dictionary and make sure that I knew every, you know, every meaning listed. I actually, in order to make sure I didn't miss anything, the method that I used was doing it first by hand in a notebook, which is actually how Cesar writes. He writes in a notebook. So I did it first by hand, and then transcribed it to the computer later, so that I've read this book more times than any other book I've ever read. I've probably read it 10 times. I've almost undoubtedly read it more times than Cesar has, actually. And then, like, several rounds of editing after New Directions picked it up. So I just really, really didn't want to mess up. And I think, if anything, on a next book, I would probably give myself a little bit more leeway, you know, to make interpretive choices. But it's sort of a white knuckle grip on my dictionary is maybe what I was bringing to the table.
Right. It's that idea that the fear that you won't, that the meaning of something might be lost on you in the original, and then you'll be wrong. You'll represent Aira wrong.
I would misrepresent this person's work after he took a chance on me for absolutely no reason. So that was a worry. And also, translation is a funny thing. I remember in a Spanish class at college, a professor said, the thing about translation is that it's hard to do and easy to criticize.
Yes.
And of course, this is true of most things, but it's especially true in this case, because anyone who knows the language can say, well, why didn't you use this word? You know, for every single word. And it's like, well, you know, you have to vindicate those choices. It's tough.
Now, looking at this book so closely, reading it so many times, like you've said, and looking closely, no doubt, at Aira's other work as well, I want to know what the experience so far has of being so close to Aira's work has taught you about the way the way fiction writing works, or maybe more specifically, what does Ira bring to fiction writing that if someone listening writes fiction could benefit from, you know, because this guy, his books have their own kind of excitingness that I don't find in a lot of other authors. And I think a lot of people in the Anglosphere are realizing that now, thanks to translations like yours and others. But just in terms of not even in the Spanish language, but in general terms, what is it you learn about fiction from Ira?
What he's doing is similar to the moment in painting when people started to make their brushstrokes visible. And I'm not, you know, and I'm not saying that he's the first person to do this kind of stuff. But I think that that when you're reading his book, he allows his brushstrokes to be visible. So you can actually, you know, you trace like the evolution of a thought or of a plot point that he's having, and you can see it emerge and see it go back down. So there's a lot of times in fiction, you know, that there's not, because there are no materials, strictly speaking, there's no physicality. A lot of times you don't get a sense of how it is constructed because it's an invisible process. But for him, it is fairly visible. He allows you to see it. So I think that's part of what's exciting about it.
And in the last segment of this program, when we spoke with Chris Andrews, who's done a few Ira translations and who also translates Roberto Bolaño, you know, I kind of made the ridiculous move of asking him about to maybe draw some kind of comparison between those two authors, knowing that there wasn't a lot of a comparison to be made. But, you know, I can't shake the idea that there are more exciting things going on in literature in the Spanish language, and there have been more exciting things in the past few decades than in English. And given that I'm sure you have more experience right there in the original with Spanish language fiction than I do, can you tell me anything about whether my impression there is true or false, or if it's just like a figment that the U.S. publishing landscape is forcing on me because they've been bringing out authors like Ira and Bolaño? What's going on there?
Every language has its own tradition. I think that because in the United States and in the English language, in a sense, you have the luxury of a particular type of mass market, there's a lot less tolerance for experimentation, I think. Mm. So I think that's part of it. In Argentina, especially because of kind of the legacy of Borges, there is a lot of respect for forms that are not really saleable in the U.S., like the short story, sort of unconventional length novels and stuff like that. So I think they have more room. I mean, he would never have gotten published in the United States if he were an English language writer, I don't think. I think that the U.S. really has a tilts pretty strongly in its tradition towards a realist style. The Southern Cone, you know, Chile, Uruguay, and Argentina have a tradition that mixes in a lot more elements of, I mean, you know, people cringe at this point whenever you use the word magical realism to talk about Spanish language writing. But
right.
I would actually argue that it's more a matter of that realism is one specific genre, and that it's just anything outside of that is what we tend to call magical realism. But anyway, it has a tradition of mixing genres a bit more, of mixing sort of cheap, fast and cheap genre fiction with kind of lengthy intellectual asides, and you know, mixing all these things together. Because of the history of the last 30 years in Chile and Argentina, writers are much more used to operating outside of society, kind of not outside of society, but outside of the establishment, outside of power structures. So they're more comfortable maybe messing with boundaries, you might say.
And the amount of boundary messing that Ira has done over all of his books, I mean, there's so many that remain untranslated. What do you, you know, whether or not you would be the one to translate it, what do you want to see come to the English language from his body of work?
A book that I read actually just recently called Emma la Cautiva, Emma the Captive, which is essentially a cowboy novel of Argentina, which is an interesting parallel historically between the U.S. and Argentina. We both have this kind of frontier history. It's a novel about a young woman who is with a group of prisoners who are banished to the frontier, which in this case is along the Pampa, south of Buenos Aires. Actually, so near Coronel Pringles, which is where The Seamstress in the Wind is set, but this is in the 19th century. And it's a very beautiful kind of Italo Calvino reminiscent story of this woman just sort of, you know, moving from place to place and building a life in this landscape, which is mostly realistic, but is constantly edging over into things that are probably not real. And I love that sense of where you're like, I think this is probably not real.
Maybe.
I'm not 100% sure because this is another time in another place and you never know. But, you know, like packs of wild dogs that don't bark, things like that. They have these like, their eyes are all bloodshot and they have like big bags under them and they're walking around just silently in the pampas. I think that's probably comes from Cesare Ayo's imagination, but I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah, but a striking image nonetheless.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, I would love to do that. I would love to do some of the short stories, which I don't think have been bundled up and published even in Spanish. I'm not sure that he has a collection of short stories out.
I've been speaking with Rosalie Connect, the translator of The Seamstress and the Wind, which has been newly published this summer by New Directions, and it's one of Cesar Ayra's many books. I hope we'll see many more, and this has also been the final segment of our special on Ayra. So, Rosalie, thanks so much for taking the time today.
Thanks a lot.
This has been The Marketplace of Ideas, and I've been Colin Marshall. If you want to hear this show again, visit colinmarshallradio.com or open up the iTunes store and search for The Marketplace of Ideas. In either place, the complete Marketplace of Ideas program archive is completely free for the download. The website of Ben Althaus, the man who makes our theme music, is available, as always, at benalthaus.com. And if you want weekly updates on the Marketplace of Ideas, current shows, upcoming ones, all kinds of Marketplace of Ideas-related information, sign up for the Marketplace of Ideas mailing list at colinmarshallradio.com. If you have any comments, questions, feedback, or guest suggestions, do send those along to Colin, C-O-L-I-N, at colinmarshallradio.com. It is Colin at colinmarshallradio.com, and I will almost certainly read it. Thanks, as always, for tuning in, and we will catch you next time on the Marketplace of Ideas for more cultural conversation of the depth you demand. Yeah.